Hello, Revit users. I'm Alfredo Medina. I am a licensed architect and a member of the Autodesk Expert Elite group. In this video, I want to talk about Toposolid, a new feature in Revit 2024. On the right, I have Snagit with the list of topics that I want to cover. And on the left, I have Revit 2024, and I have opened a sample project from 2023. My first topic is categories and subcategories. This is a topography. This is a subregion. And if we go to a section view of this building, we will see that there is a building pad with the same footprint of the building. Those are the usual categories and subcategories that we used in Revit 2023. Let's go to visibility graphics. If we type T on this list, we can see that the topography category and subcategories still exist the same. Notice that topography has a subcategory called triangulation edges. The next category is toposolid, and toposolid has these subcategories. Notice that it doesn't have triangulation edges. I wish there was the same triangulation edges for toposolid. We will see that later. Let's close the visibility graphics window. Can we edit a topography that comes from a previous version? Let's see. If I click on the topography, I don't have the tools to modify my points anymore. All I have is generate toposolid. Can I change a subregion from previous versions? Yes, I can click on Edit Boundary to change the boundary of the subregion. And if I go to a section view of this project, we see that there is a building pad from the previous version. Can I still modify this? Yes, I can click on Edit Boundary, go to a site plan view, and modify the sketch of the building pad. But this will be ignored once we convert the topo surface into a topo solid. So this tool, building pad, is gone. So let me cancel that and let's go back to the 3D view. Now let's talk about methods for creating a topo solid. The first method is converting an existing topo surface into a topo solid, like this. We have this existing topography. We click on the topography and click on Generate Topo Solid. Notice, for the first time, you need to understand what Revit is going to do. It says that the subregions will be converted into subdivisions. Building paths will be ignored. Railings, if they are hosted on the topography, they will be rehosted to the toposolid. And of course, it asks for a base level and a type of family, because now you can have types of toposolids. Okay, so let's click OK to this and see what happens. One thing that we notice at the beginning is that the topo surface was not deleted. So if we make a selection here and we go to filter, we see that there is a topography and a topo solid. So Revit does not delete the existing topography. Okay. So if I want to delete the topography, I can select it, delete it, And now what I have is a topo solid. So what are the main differences between this topo solid and the topo surface? Well, the first one, obviously, is that this is no longer a surface, but it is a volume. As you can see, the lowest point in this solid is this area here. If we measure this distance, that distance is the thickness that is applied in the properties of the toposolid family. If we go to this elevation, for example, where we can see the whole topography, and if we measure the thickness of the lowest portion from here to here, we can see that in this metric project, that distance is 300. Where is that coming from? Well, if we click on the toposolid and we go to edit type, if we click on structure edit, we can see that toposolids can have layers in the same way as floors or ceilings or roofs can have layers of materials. Because this one was converted from a topo surface, it has only one default material and a default thickness of 300 millimeters. This layer, considered the core boundary of the topo solid, is variable. This is what gives that volume here, beginning from the lowest point to whatever is the highest elevation of the terrain. If we uncheck variable, then this is what happens. We click OK. Revit issues this message about the thickness, etc. Let's click OK to this. And now the 300 millimeters is applied to the whole surface, like this, right? So now it looks like a surface, but it continues to be a solid with 300 millimeters. So I guess since the idea now is that this works as a solid, let's keep that setting of variable. Let's go back to edit type, structure edit, and activate variable for this layer and click OK. And click OK to this. And now we have the volume again. Another important difference is surface patterns. If we go to a site plan view, this is not showing any surface pattern because the default material doesn't have any surface pattern. But in previous versions of Revit, we could not assign a surface pattern to the topography. Only in section views, we could specify one pattern for earth, for example. But here, we can have surface patterns like this. Edit type, structure edit. Let's suppose that I want to apply a material to this. If I go to, let's say, grass, I find this material, and if I want, I can apply something to the surface. Let's suppose that I want, just to go quickly on this, let's see these lines, for example, and let's click OK. That's a surface pattern, and if I want a cut pattern different than this, let's suppose that I want this pattern, let's click OK. Click OK, close this window, close all of these windows, and now you can see that surface patterns are available for plan views, and if I go to sections, let's remove the crop region of this view, also let's change the detail level to medium or fine. And then we can see that the topo solid has a surface pattern. We can have layers. If we go to edit type and click on structure edit and create a couple of more layers like this, let's suppose that we move this one up and that this one is going to be the grass, the one that is above, and that this one is something else, such as sand. Let's click on this and we put a cut pattern to the sand to be sand dense, for example, for that layer. And for a third layer, we create we use earth, the typical earth material, like this. And let's suppose that this is this function, and then we go to earth and we see that earth has a cut pattern, the typical earth pattern. That's okay. Let's click okay. And now we put some thicknesses to this. Let's suppose that this is the same 300 and that this is also 300. We have a total of 900 millimeters and three layers. Let's see how this looks when we click OK. Let's click OK to this. And now you can see that we have three layers of material. Notice what Revit is doing. The second layer has to adapt to the thickness, to the configurations, and that's because that's the layer that is variable, right? So maybe it's better if we go to edit type, go to structure edit, and instead of this one being the variable layer, we say no, only the lowest layer is variable. Let's click OK. Click OK. And now this makes more sense. You see? So it is important which layer is assigned to be variable. So that's another important enhancement that I see in topo solids over topo surface. Now let's talk about creating a topo solid from an imported CAD. Let's open a new model. Let's use the default template. Let's go to a 3D view and let's do this. Insert, import CAD. Here I have a sample topography with elevated contours. Let's choose import units, feet. Everything else is okay. Let's click open. So this is my topography. Now to convert this to a toposolid, you go to Massing and Sight, toposolid, create from import, create from CAD, click on the imported CAD. From here, select the layers that have the contours. In this case, topo major and topo minor, and click OK. Notice before clicking OK that this template comes with a certain default topo solid with three layers. Let's click OK. And now we have a topo solid created from the imported CAD. Let's go to VG and hide the annotation content in this view. And now the DWG is no longer needed. We can select it with filter, select the DWG file, unpin it, and delete it. This template comes with a working section. Let's go to that section to see the Toposolid. Notice that when the detail level is set to coarse, you don't see the layers of the Toposolid, similar to what happens with walls and other tools with layers. So let's change this to medium or fine. And then now we can see the layers of materials. If we go to the properties of the Toposolid, go to structure edit, we can see how it was configured. One upper layer for grass, another layer in the core boundary for gravel, and another one for earth. And the lowest layer, as we saw before, is the variable layer. Okay. So this is fine. Let's move on to the next topic. Optionally, you can create a Toposolid using a CSV file with a list of points. Let me delete the previous Toposolid that we created based on the CAD file. And this time we will do the same Toposolid using CSV file. Let's do this. Massing and site, Toposolid, create from import, create from CSV. And here I have a list of points for the same site. Let's click on that. Let's choose the units to be feet. Let's click OK. And the Toposolid is created. In previous tests that I have made, I have observed that this method produces a more accurate representation of the topography. This CSV file was created using a AutoLisp routine from the AutoCAD file, and it's basically a list of all coordinates for X, Y, and Z of all the lines of the contours. If you'd like to receive that AutoLisp routine, please subscribe to my channel, write WP in the comments, and give me your email address. Thank you. The other method to create a Toposolid is by sketch and points. I don't see this as a practical method for creating a complete site, but it could be used for smaller, simpler areas. Let me explain why. Here in AutoCAD, I created a flat version of the sample topography. The flat lines are elevated at 157 feet from zero. And I am using only the topo major layer to make it simpler. So what happens if I want to use this as a guideline to create a Toposolid by sketch and points? Let's see. In Revit, I am on the site plan view. I have also a section and a 3D view open. Let me maximize Revit and then use view tile views to see all three views at the same time. And let's work here on the site plan first. Let's bring that AutoCAD drawing. Insert, import CAD, sample topography flat, import units feet, click open. If I want to create this topography by sketch and points, I need to do this. Massing and site, Toposolid, create from sketch. Notice that instead of points, now I have all the typical tools that I would have for creating floors, for example. Before making my sketch or before finishing, I should establish the elevation of the site. In this case, it would be 157 feet from level 1. Then the sketch refers to the boundary of the surface only. So I could use pick lines, and I could take these lines from the AutoCAD file, and that gives me the boundary. And if I click finish, now I have a flat toposolid at 157 feet. If I zoom in, I see that it has the default thickness. But I need to add some elevations, of course. To modify this by points, you would click on the topography and then go to modify sub-elements. And the first thing you would need to do is to edit the elevations of the points on the boundary, right? So let's assume that these three points here are at 157. So we're gonna keep them as they are, 157. How about this point and this point? These are 160. So I go here and change the elevation of these two points to 160 and enter. And this point and this point are at 170. So I'm going to select this and that and change the elevation to be 170 feet. But see what happens with the site. I start seeing all of these triangulations that are cluttering the view. The more points I edit, the more of those lines I get. Let's continue with this one and this one, which are on the same contour. Those are at 175 feet. And then this one is 180 feet. And this one over here is also 180. See, so this is just editing the boundary points. If I want to add points in the center, for example, of course I haven't finished, but I said I wouldn't be finishing all of this. Suppose that this area is at 190 feet. So let's say I want to add points to my surface. Here I have these two options, along the surface or absolute elevation. I would prefer in this case absolute elevation, which is easier to understand. So let me type here 190, and I want to put some points here. There is no way to snap to the guidelines, so I just have to guess some points. But as I place more points, all of these lines make it difficult to do this because they get on the way and I don't get to see exactly where I want to see clearly. And there's no way to get rid of those lines. Unfortunately, if I go to, let's click on modify. If I go to VG, if I type T, if I go to Toposolid, I have this hidden lines, common edges, folding lines, which is off, split lines. So let's suppose that I hide all of these other subcategories and I leave only the primary contours. Let's hide all of this, click apply. Now I see only the major, but let's try to continue editing this. I click on the toposolid, click on modify sub elements, but I still see all of these triangulations, which make this very awkward and not practical to create a site, in my opinion. So I wouldn't use this to create a site only for smaller areas. Okay. One advantage that Toposolids have the same drawing tools as floors is that we could create a Toposolid adapt to certain existing edges of other things. For example, here I have four slabs located at different elevations. You can see the elevations: 1 foot, 3 feet, 8 feet, and 13 feet. If I go to a 3D view, it looks like this. So suppose that I want to create a Toposolid around these edges. So I could go to the site plan and do this: massing and site, Toposolid, create from sketch. And here either I draw lines like this, or I could use pick lines and pick some of the existing edges like this. Or I could use the align tool and say align to this edge, align this line, or let's connect this edge to this corner, this edge to this corner, this one to this corner. Let's pick lines here. Let's connect these two corners like this. And let's connect this to that. And let's trim this corner. Just an example, right? The elevation is zero. If I click finish on this, if I go to the 3D view, what I have is a flat solid in between all of those slabs, right? But since this works like a floor, I could do this: Toposolid, modify sub elements, and then simply click on this edge and either enter the elevation that I need or simply drag this arrow and push it to the, let's say, the lower edge of the slab, like this. Let's do the same on the other side. For example, this one goes up to the underside of the slab, and you can see that the line snaps to that edge. That is good. We can do it on this other side as well. Let's say this goes up to that line. Okay, so if I go back to the plan view, I could make this side be lower than everything so that I have a low point here. Let's say this one is 6 inches, like this, and then finish the sketch like this. Notice that this Toposolid has more contour lines and a thicker thickness than the default. And that's because I went to the properties of the Toposolid and I used contour display, which is now a type property of the Toposolid. You can click on edit and adjust the interval values for how often you want to see primary contours and secondary contours. Also, I had changed the thickness of the earth layer in the properties. Now, let's talk about how to modify the Toposolid. I have linked a sample rectangular building. I have named this instance A and this other instance B. For one of the buildings, we have to add earth to the site and for the other one we have to excavate. Let's go back to the site and see the sections for building A. Let's go to this section. This is how it looks. This is the level that I specified for this building. And if I go to the other section, this is the location where we want this building. So we have to add earth here and maybe put a retention wall. Let's go back to the site and let's look at the sections for building B. Let's go to this section. This is building B. I have a level B over here. So for this one, if I go to the other section, you will see that for this one, we want to excavate. Let's go back to the site plan. Before making changes to the Toposolid, it would be good to use the graded region tool so that the existing Toposolid remains in the existing phase and the new Toposolid is in the new construction phase. The benefits of that is that you can keep track of the contour lines that were changed, and also you could create a calculation of cut and fill in a schedule. So to do that, I'm going to select the Toposolid, change the phase created property to existing, and then use the graded region tool. Click on massing and site, click on graded region, create a new topography exactly like the existing one. Yes, that's what I want. I click on this one. And now I have two topographies, one in the existing phase and the other one on the new construction phase. Let's work on building A. In this section, I drew a couple of reference planes to guide me in the site plan about the area that I want to infill. I see the two reference planes here. One is here, the other one is over here. So to infill the site, I have seen three methods that seem to work fine. You can use a model family, like a solid extrusion. You can use a model in place solid extrusion. And you can use also a piece of Toposolid as well. And then join geometry. Let's do set work plane. And let's use that level A that I have created for building A. And then now I can use, let's say, model in place. Architecture component, model in place. But let's keep it as Toposolid. Toposolid number one, that's fine. Let's change the view to hidden line so that I can see better. And then I do an extrusion like this. I can use pick lines and use my reference planes, this, and then use, let's say something else like this, and this goes like that. Let's suppose that this is the shape, and then we trim these corners. Revit will create an extrusion, in this case of 5 feet height. That's fine. We will continue in the section view anyway. Let's click on finish and let's go to the section one, section A1. And this is our new model in place Toposolid. So here I would need to stretch this so that it merges with the other one, and then maybe move this to the necessary elevation, something like this, right? And then finish the model. Then I use join geometry. Click on one of the elements, click on the toposolid, and now the two things merge into one. If I go to my 3D view, this is the result. If I set the view to shaded mode, this is what I see. If I go to the side plane, this is what I see. And as we saw before, now we have the ability to put surface patterns to the toposolid entities. So you can do that to the new toposolid, adding a material to represent a different surface. If you want to add a retention wall, for example, you can do that here on the site. You need to begin with, let's say, architecture wall architecture. For example, basic wall retaining 12-inch concrete. I need to use that level A that I created as a base. So let's say base constraint, level A. And let's suppose that we do -8 feet, and the wall goes up from there some 9 feet. We can change that in the section if necessary. And then let's suppose that we draw our retention wall here. Then let's go to this section. And here is our retention wall. If necessary, we can make changes to the height of the retention wall, for example. And if we go to the site plan view, we can add a footing, for example, structure, wall, and then click on the retaining wall. And then go to our section again, section A2. And now we see the footing with the retention wall. If you want to avoid this graphics that the toposolid shows through the retention wall, you can use cut geometry between the toposolid and the wall, like this. Cut geometry from this toposolid. I want to cut the wall, and then the graphics get better. So this is an example of adding a material to the site. For building B, where we need to excavate, the process is similar, but we use a void to subtract that volume from the toposolid. I placed a couple of reference planes again. Let's go to the site plan view. This is my location. So let's do architecture component model in place. Let's do it as a toposolid. Click OK. Toposolid number 2, but this time, instead of using a solid, I use a void form. It could be any shape, really, but to make it simple, I'm going to make it a simple rectangle. So let's do the void using these reference planes, like this, and then let's use this one. Let's put this one here, and let's trim these corners. A and click on finish, and we will take care of the depth in section. So let's go to section B2. This is the new void. Then we need to push down the base of that void to the desired elevation, let's say below this slab, and then make sure that the top face of the void intersects the site as well. Before finishing, you need to do cut geometry, click on the toposolid, and then click on the void, and click on finish. And this is the result in 3D. And of course, you can add retention walls, change materials, etc. If you need to modify the volume, either this volume or this void volume, you need to select it, in this case, toposolid number 2, then click on edit in place, then click on the extrusion, and now you have access to the controls, and you can either change the sketch or stretch faces, and then finish model, and the toposolid will be modified. Using this technique that we just saw, you could model tunnels or underground structures, like in this sample image from the help documents. When we go back to the site plan, notice that you can see the lines of the existing toposolid that were modified. I changed the facing graphics override to be in red so that you can see it better. And we can see them because the phase filter of the view is show all. If you put this in show complete, then you won't see the existing toposolid. Now let's talk about subdivide. I want to create a path that begins here, connects the two buildings, and goes out on the other side of the site. To do that, I click on the toposolid, click on subdivide. Then, to go quickly, I could use a spline and begin, let's say, somewhere here, and provide points to go like this, following the contour lines, like this, like that, like that, like this. This is good enough. Then I click on finish. And now if I go to my 3D view, I should have a subdivision which can have different materials. The subdivision has a thickness that I can define here. Also, there is the choice of showing or not showing the contour lines on the path. For example, let's make this shaded. At the moment, the path is showing the contour lines, you see? But this is an option that I can turn off, and then it looks like this. Well, off camera, I tried some site components. I put some trees along the path. I put a couple of people walking on the path. What about split? There is no split toposolid command. Instead, you can use the split tool, which has been enhanced. When you click on the toposolid, it opens drawing tools for you to draw the boundaries that will split a toposolid into. For example, let's use pick lines and select this reference plane to split this toposolid in these two parts. Let's click on finish. Let's see what happens. Okay, now I have two topo solids, one and two. However, there is not an equivalent to merge surfaces. If I try to join geometry, for example, let's see, join geometry, this and that. And now I get an error saying that the two parts cannot be joined again. Okay. Now let's talk about some annotation content, contour labels. If you want to put labels on this toposolid, but maybe not for every contour line, you need to go to the properties of the toposolid, click on Edit for Contour Display, uncheck the secondary contours, and then create label contours in the usual way, drawing a like section line through the site, and click on Modify. And now we have the labels as usual. For property lines, nothing changes. We go to, for example, create by sketching, and I draw my property lines, finish. Spot elevations, let's see, annotate spot elevation. Yes, I can place any elevation anywhere. Spot coordinate should work the same way as usual. And finally, let's see cut and fill volumes. View schedules and quantities. In this case, we go to topo solid. Phase new construction. Let's click OK. And let's pass to the right. Cut, fill, net cut and fill. And if we want, we can put a mark to identify portions. Then we go to formatting and apply calculations to these three fields. Let's click OK. This is not working. I made a test in another model. In that model, if I change the size of the void volume that I used to cut the site, yes, the cut and fill schedule updates. But in this one, not even the void is calculated properly. In the other model, the volume that I used to add material to the site is completely ignored by the cut and fill schedule. For example, if I take this void that I did before and I increase the void, and just to make sure that it is cutting the topography, I'm going to a section and I'm going to make this big enough like this and even like this. And you can see that the schedule says calculating, and when I click finish, it doesn't give me the result. So this is not working. And this is my summary and review of this topic. For each feature, I have assigned a symbol. Works, needs work, or an X for does not work. Let's begin. About the toposolid, the ability to see a surface pattern on a terrain in plan view, that is a good addition that works fine. the ability to see layers of materials of the terrain in section, that is a good addition and it's working fine. The ability to create toposolids by import, either CAD or CSV file, that's working well. The ability to create toposolid by sketching and adding points, and the ability to modify contours. It was easier to edit points in previous versions of Revit. Designers need to see contour lines while editing the terrain, similar to editing points in a topography, not triangulations. I can understand this and I can work with this. I cannot work points, contours with this. Let's continue. The ability to set a building on the terrain and do cut and fill. It is time consuming. Now you need a solid to add material and a void to cut material. The building pad was removed, but in my opinion, it was a simple, efficient way to do cut and fill in one single step with only one 2D sketch, as we can see here. In this session, I showed building A, in which I was adding material, building B, in which I was excavating, but most of the situations require fill and cut, like this. And for this, building pad was more efficient. About subdivisions, the ability to create walkways or hardscape on a topography, it needs work. I think it needs layers of materials, and it needs the ability to put the subdivision material inside the toposolid, not projecting above the toposolid. Look at this sketch and think of a simple walkway on your neighborhood. This is the way it is done, not on top of the surface. Site components, trees, parking spots, entourage, yes, that's working fine. Annotations, label contours, spot elevations, spot coordinates, property lines. Yes, that is working. Split toposolid, the ability to separate portions of a toposolid and merge them again. Yes and no. There is an enhanced split tool with drawing tools to draw the cutting edges, and that works fine to split the toposolid. But once the toposolid is split, it cannot be merged again. Schedules, the ability to calculate the amount of earth removed, added, and a net value. No, it's not working. Thanks for watching.